What's up, Elevate fam? My name is Blake, and I'm your host for Church at Home. Thank you guys for tuning in this Sunday. It's going to be an amazing Sunday. We're going to have worship. We're going to have service. But first, a few announcements from me. Number one, if this is your first time here with us at Elevate People, I encourage you to do a few things. Number one, text the word home to the number that you see on the screen. What that will do is we'll send you a online connect card because we want to know more about you. All right. So you fill it out with your information, you know, click submit. And then what we'll do is we'll send you a video of Pastor Brandon Barber sharing his heart and soul for the church so you can learn a little bit more about us. So please do that right now if you can. We're so thankful that you're here with us. Another thing we love to do at Elevate is we love to give. We are a church with a very generous heart. We love to serve Houston, the city, people who need it. And so if you want to be a part of that mission, there's a couple ways that you can be a part. Number one, you can text the amount that you want to give to the number on the screen, or you can scan the QR code that's right around here, and that will take you to our online giving page where you can you know, fill out the form however much you want to give. We still have our No Limits offering that's still going on, so if you weren't at service the past couple Sundays, didn't tune in, you still have an opportunity to sow seeds into the new year through our No Limits offering. And the third way you can give is through our Hope app. So the Hope app is what you'll search on the App Store. You can get it on an iPhone or Android. And you can also give through the Hope app to Elevate People. So I encourage you guys to do that. Well, if we're about to start service, but if there's at any moment you feel led to need prayer, I really encourage you to text the word prayer to the number on the screen or type prayer in the comments. We'll have a crew member waiting and we'll reach out to you to pray with you and pray for you. At the end of the service, if you feel like you want to give your heart to Jesus, first of all, that's amazing. That's a thing to rejoice about. But also, we want to know about it. So text Jesus to the number that you see on the screen or type Jesus in the comments after service, and we'll have someone to reach out and give you more information about what that looks like to lead your life following Jesus. This is it, guys. 2020 is almost done. We're almost to 2021. So get excited, get pumped, and join us for the next few Sundays. Stay tuned. Let's get up for worship and let's have a good Sunday.
What's up, Elevate People? Hope you guys are doing well today. Let's get ready to worship.
With just one word, you calm the storm that surrounds me. With just one word, the darkness has to retreat. With just one touch, I feel the presence of heaven. With just one touch, my eyes were open to see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. With just one word, You heal what's broken inside me. With just one word, and You revive every dream. In just one touch, I feel the power of heaven. In just one touch, my eyes can't help but see. My heart can't help but believe. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can't move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's nothing that our God can't do. will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like the power of Jesus. I will believe for greater things. There's no power like the power of Jesus. Let faith arise, let all agree. There's no power like His power. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a prison wall He can't break through. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's nothing that our God can't do. There's not a mountain that He can move. Oh, praise the name that makes a way. There's nothing that our God can't do.
As we step into this next moment of worship, I just encourage everyone to lift their hands. Begin to posture your heart. Posture your heart in a place of receiving.
Thank you, Lord. We thank you. There is a promise that points beyond my faith. There is a still voice to silence all my fears. Even the worst of my mistakes are miracles in the making. Are miracles in the making. By your strength
you are peace. Just tuning in with us, I want to welcome you again. Thank you for hanging out with us for Church at Home here at Elevate People. We're so glad that you're here. There's some information on the screen where you can text the word home to get some more information about who we are, learn the heart and soul of our church. So whether you Elevate family here in Houston or you're part of our online family, we glad you're here. Come on, those in the room, can we welcome everybody watching here today? We're glad you're here. And also, if you've not done this, we love to give. We believe in being generous in our church. So a simple act of generosity right now, if you're watching through Facebook or other platform, you can actually share this service right now. And for every share, we're going to donate $2 to local missions to help families in need in our city. Come on, somebody. Ain't that right? Just simple. You ain't even got to give. You just got to click a button and you impacting lives. So do that right now for us. And I believe God is going to use that to help us reach more people. I'm excited to continue our theme, this series. Our theme for the year has been No Limits. And come on, somebody shout No Limits. Come on, in the room. Type No Limits in the comments. And we're in this quarter called Rise, and believing that God has called us to rise to everything that He has called us to. During this pandemic, we're not backing down. In fact, we're busier than ever. Come on, all right? We're loving on our city, and we're reaching people like crazy. And I do want to give a shout out, because I think we about a week in, to all the mamas, all the teachers, come on, that are working so hard. Can we give it up for all of our teachers and our schools and our principals, all the moms who found out you were a teacher at the last second, trying to figure it out. Man, come on, stack up on grace, husband, let's go. And let me tell you, things are wild, and all of our kids are in-person/virtual, and my son is actually the only kid in his class, physically, and he came home with a conduct mark. How does that even happen? Homie came, it's like he was talking. To who? He's the only one in the room, disrupting him. I'm just kidding, I'm totally kidding. But he's got an amazing teacher, and man, it's just life. Life is just crazy right now. But in the midst of the crazy, wouldn't you agree, guys, here, that man, we have seen the goodness of God in multiple ways and forms. Am I right? Amen? And I believe God is going to continue to do that today. I'm excited about God's word. I'm very passionate about this, what I want to talk about. If you got your Bibles, turn with me to Luke chapter 4. And also find 2 Corinthians chapter 10. Luke chapter 4 and 2 Corinthians chapter 10. I'm going to pray, then I'll get to those here in just a moment. I'm actually going to read a lot of scripture to you guys today. So if you don't follow along with me in your Bible or on your phone watching, just write it down. Take notes. And I encourage you, this is a day to take notes with what I want to talk about. And if you're taking notes, actually, here's the title of my message. I want to talk to you about breaking new ground. Come on, somebody. Come on, how many is ready for some good new things in your life? Let's go. Things that feel like being held back, things that you feel like have dried up, I'm ready to break some new ground. Come on, I'm ready to rise up and believe God like never before. In other words, I want you to ask yourself this question, write it down. Do I need freedom? Amen. Do I need freedom? And I'm talking about this because this Sunday is Small Groups Launch Sunday. Let's go, come on. Like we're fired. We believe that groups take us from a congregation to a family. And even though we're not able to gather in person right now, we can still connect more than ever before through virtual online groups. We got some groups that are meeting with social distance guidelines. I mean, there's no reason in the world for us to sit back, but there's every reason for us to lean in and be involved in church like never before. And to lean into relationships, we're going to grow this year. And part of that, we believe that our job at Elevate is to lead you to do our best to lead you to an encounter with Jesus. But then past that, It's like my soul comes alive when I say yes to Jesus, like, woo! But then the rest of me's got to catch up. Anybody got a little fixing left to do in your life? Come on. Don't lie in church. Come on, right? We need some help. I need some help. And so the Bible calls that freedom. And I believe God wants to break some new ground in your life. And I think he wants to do some new things. And it might take a little bit of humbling ourselves and saying, yep, I need help. Yep. Where you don't let shame grip you anymore. You don't let shame take you down. You're afraid to admit, like, if people knew that I was looking or thinking or doing this, they would totally think opposite of me. Don't let the shame take you down. But finding humility to say, I love Jesus, but there's some things that are holding me back. But I'm ready to break some new ground in my life, and I'm going to rise up to be everything that God called me to be. Amen on that? I believe God's going to do it. Let's pray. Father, we love you. We thank you. Thank you for your worship, this word. And just, I pray that you speak to us today, just clearly, boldly. And it just doesn't just be a Sunday or a moment where we take notes and then we don't apply it. No, Father, I pray we leave here today. And I pray freedom is found. Healing is going to come. A touch from heaven is going to happen. It's already happening, God. We feel it in the room, and our friends feel it watching, God. Just continue to be with us, Father. In Jesus' name we pray, and everybody said in the room and online, somebody say, amen, 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 amen. I'm fired up about this. Breaking new ground. Like I said, our passion to elevate is to do our best to love people to encounter with Jesus. That's our mission statement. But once you meet Jesus, the rest of me has got to catch up. The best way to describe that is we know the story in the Bible when Jesus delivered his people out of Egypt. Even though they were physically free, right? They were still spiritually bound. You can be walking free, but yet still be held back and more miserable than ever. Well, I know this through being in prison ministry, and our church is in prison ministry. And by the way, can you help me celebrate right now? This message and these services are going into friends that are behind the prison walls all around the country. Come on, can we show them some love? We're glad you're here hanging out with us. We love you. And we love to say, even though you might be in prison, prison don't have to be in you, right? The world has tagged you with a number. Your dad, God, knows you by your name. We love you. And we're glad that you're here hanging out with our church family. But I know this, talking to many friends in prison and being in prison ministry for so long my whole life, I've met more people freer in prison than out in the world. So it has nothing to do with the physical nature when it comes to freedom. I can say I love Jesus and still be miserable on the inside. The Bible calls this freedom. Meaning, yes, Jesus, I want to give you my life. But I still got some emotions I got to work out. I still got some habits I got to get rid of. Come on, are you with me? How many are ready to get rid of the little Debbie's habit you got in COVID? Let's go. I wish I had the video. Man, I introduced my children to their first ever Popeye's biscuit. Let's go. They about fainted. Come on, am I right? I got one daughter in the room, Braylon. She's like, whoo, Jesus. I immediately thought, this is amazing. And then I thought, I'm a horrible father waiting 15 years to introduce my children to Popeyes for the first time. What's up with that? I got to get better at fatherhood. Help a brother out. But the deal is that there's some things that we need to get. We've allowed relationships to be hurt that God intended to be into our lives. And we're letting just one conversation or one thing and all of a sudden bitterness rises up. And you love Jesus, but the bitterness is taking you out. And unforgiveness is just taking you out left and right. And all of a sudden, pride rises up on the inside of you. And if you know the devil, the Bible says that pride is what kicked the devil out of heaven. And if pride can kick the devil out of heaven, then it can kick heaven out of you. And here we are, we say yes to Jesus, but ask ourselves, do I need freedom? Are there some things in my life that are holding me back from being everything that God has called me to be? Holding my marriage back from being as fruitful as it should be. My family, my friendships, my life. Luke 4 verse 18 says this. It's a base scripture for us. Luke 4 verse 18. You got to believe this over your life. Say it with the declaration. And this is really a declaration as a pastor and as a leader and as a minister. I'm supposed to pray this and proclaim this over your life. And I want you to hear it from that perspective. The Spirit of the Lord is on me. That's personal. Come on, you got to make that about me. Say, it's on me. Come on, right? Because he has anointed me to proclaim the good news to the poor, and he has sent me to proclaim freedom. Come on, I'm here today to proclaim that, yes, I know you love Jesus, but I'm tired of you hurting still. I'm here to proclaim that you can have freedom. The Bible says on heaven as it is on earth. In heaven, there is no pain. On heaven, there is no sorrow. But if you can't find the joy and the happiness and the strength on earth, then what was the purpose of the cross? The purpose of the cross wasn't just for salvation, but as you can live on earth as it is in heaven. Come on, somebody, are you with me? And I don't know about you, but I want to be happy. I'm ready to be happy. Not that I'm not. I'm happy. Like, I just want to walk in freedom. Are y'all with me? Say, somebody shout, freedom.
Freedom. Freedom.
Proclaim freedom to the prisoners and recover sight to the blind, to set the oppressed free, and to proclaim, I still believe this, this can be the year of the Lord's favor on your life. Come on, do you believe that? Proclaim freedom. Proclaim freedom. Freedom is for people who say, yes, I'm saved, but I'm still not enjoying life the way that I want to. And I want you to hear me, like, lean in. If you, I don't know things, zoom in with the camera. Do, like, get as close to this ugly mug as you can. I want you to hear this. I mean this wholeheartedly. You deserve joy. You need to hear this and let it sink in your heart. Don't let it pass by. Don't fast forward. Don't check your phone. Don't look at your Facebook status or your Insta story. Lean in. You deserve joy. You deserve to be happy. You deserve to love life. You deserve to love your marriage and your family. You deserve to flow in peace financially. You deserve the joy. Psalms 43:4 says, there I will go to the altar of God, the God with the source of all my joy. God says, you deserve it. I went to the cross so you can have it. Now we got to figure out, why don't you got it? It's not that you don't love Jesus. It's not that. It's that maybe there's just something on the inside that's holding me back that's got to catch up to my salvation and my yes to Jesus. Acts 10 verse 38 says this. This is the power of how God anointed Jesus. Come on, how many believe in Jesus? Can I get a yeah in the house? Come on, all right. How many love and thankful that he's the same yesterday, today, and forever? Come on. And what he did then is the same power and anointing that he has here today. Amen? So the healings that you read about and the things that God did miraculously then, he can still do today. He can do it today. You don't have to be in the house of God to get a touch from the Lord and a touch from heaven. He can do it right where you are right now. But this is the anointing that God put on Jesus. It says God anointed Jesus with the Holy Spirit and power, and he went around doing good and healing all. Everybody shout all. Not healing those who are here and there, not healing some, but healing all who were under the power of the devil because God was with them. The Bible makes it very clear. There is a heaven and there is a hell. There is no in between. We're either under the power of God or we're under the power of the devil, the enemy. Now, some will call this, the Bible uses a word, and a ministry of Jesus is called deliverance. Now, don't freak out on me, because some people are like, oh my God, that's like that movie I saw where they're sitting down, their head spinning. No, don't freak out. We ain't talking about that, right? What we are talking about, though, is that there is an enemy. His name is the devil. And he came, the Bible says, to what? Steal, kill, and destroy. 1 John 3:8 says, the reason the Son of God came was he came to destroy the devil's work. Not to let some of it be a part of your life, but to destroy the devil's work. The devil's work is he came to steal, kill, and destroy. Of course he can say, yes, you can be saved, but still be miserable. You can love Jesus and run to the house of God week in and week out and week in and week out and still be just as miserable leaving as you walked in. Because there's still something on the inside that has to take place. Being delivered from something means, Jesus, I love you. I believe in you. But there's something that's holding me back from being everything that I know you've called me to be. Are you with me, guys? Like this is about breaking some new ground. It's about breaking some new ground. Joel 2:25 says this. The Lord says, I love this. He says, what I just read in 1 John 3:8, that Jesus came to destroy the devil's work. I love Joel 2:25, but the Lord says, I will give you back what you lost. Come on. Come on, how many believe that right now, right? Come on, I believe right now, some of you need to hear that everything you think you lost, I think you're about to break some new ground. I still think we serve a God of no limits. I still think we serve a God who wants to go beyond our wildest imagination. I think we see a God that even though our life feels right here, we serve a God who's gonna rise above that, right? And he's about to restore everything that you feel was taken from you. He's a restoration God. In other words, you got to believe that you can break free. But in order to break free, you got to know. It's like battle. I mean, you got to know what the weapons the enemy is throwing at you. Am I right? Like you study the enemy to defeat him better. Let's go, right? Like you've ever heard the phrase, don't bring a knife to a gunfight type of thing. It's kind of like that. Like you better learn what they bring and so you can bring something stronger. Let's go. And so it's kind of that phrase. So what are the weapons that I'm sitting here telling you that the enemy, the devil, is using to try to take you out, robbing your joy and robbing your strength? 2 Corinthians chapter 10, verse 3 and 5, where I told you to turn. 2 Corinthians 10, verse 3 and 5 says this. For though we live in a world, we do not wage war as the world does. The weapons we fight with are not the weapons of the world. Now, those of you who are brand new in the Lord, brand new in church, you might be like, what in the LL Cool J are you talking about? This makes no sense. The Bible says that if you love Jesus, that's the purpose of faith. We believe in a God that we don't see, but we don't need to see him to feel him. That's why we believe that a touch of heaven is gonna be active in your life today. It's just like the wind. You don't see it, but you feel it. That's how the Lord works in our lives. And he's saying, you're not of this world. I knew you before you were even in your mother's womb. And I sent you to this world. And so therefore, we're not of this world. God sent us here. Then therefore, when we're fighting the spiritual things, if God is like the wind, then we're fighting some things that we don't see, but we sure feel the impact of it. Are you following me? So that's what the Bible is talking about. He's going to wage war and weapons to where it's not physical weapons you see, but you do feel the weapon of somebody saying one thing at you that all of a sudden you were loving them, but now you hating them. And all of a sudden you didn't have bitterness in your heart, but now you got bitterness in your heart. That one text, that one wrong phone call, that one wrong email, that one bad report, all of a sudden, maybe you didn't see it all, but you felt it. It didn't look like a weapon, but it feels like a weapon. Are you following me? And it goes on to say, on the contrary, just felt like saying that. They have divine power to, underline this in your Bible. Here's the key. To demolish strongholds. Here's what the power of God does. Demolish strongholds. He would demolish arguments and every pretension. I'm going to explain this. That sets itself up against the knowledge of God. And it says we take captive every thought to make it obedient to Christ. I preached a message last week talking about a call of bringing us back to obedience. If you missed it, I encourage you to go back and listen to it because I believe these 2 weeks kind of flow together. So it says demolish stronghold. What is a stronghold? If you want to write this down, a stronghold is a prisoner locked by deception. It's going to be up on your screen. A prisoner locked by deception. Living life by something that is not true. In other words, let me say it like this. You've let the devil trick you into believing something that you are not. You've let the devil trick you into thinking that something is bigger than it really is. You've let the devil trick you into thinking that everybody else thinking this about you, but they're not. You serve a God who says, when you give your life to me, he washes your sins clean and he sees it no more. And if God doesn't see it anymore, then why are you still looking at it? He has tricked you to see something. It is not who you are. He said he came to demolish a stronghold, to demolish strongholds. In other words, a stronghold is the very thing that has got you gripped, that is holding you back from being everything. Like I mentioned, it might be a habit. It might be one little thing. Jesus, all throughout the Bible, he's incredible. And where he says, we see the story after story, he's all about the one. In fact, we love to say that here at Elevate, it's all about the one. He leaves the 99 to leave for the one. How many have had those moments where there's hundreds of people in the room at church, but you feel like Jesus and the preacher is talking right to you? He's about the one. He has an amazing gift, the Holy Spirit, for the one. But he's not just about the one person. He came to the cross for the one thing. And that one thing is holding you back from being everything that God called you to be. You've let pride rise up, and it's destroying a friendship. And it's destroying your marriage. And it's destroying your family. And it's causing you, all of a sudden you contradicted the word of God. And it's like, man, I'm just doing it once a week on Tuesday night. It ain't that bad. It's like you just, all of a sudden, you let one thing just pull you back into addiction and lust and money and bad thoughts, and it is shaking you to a place to where you never thought you would go again. And Jesus says, whatever you're feeling, whatever you're thinking right now, I went to the cross to demolish that. And in Jesus' name, it's not going to be a part of your life anymore. But we're going to break some new ground. Come on, are you with me? And we believe the healing touch of heaven is for you today. It's for you today. The second thing he said, I want you to get this. He says he came to demolish every pretension. Get this in scripture. Demolish every pretension that sets itself up against the truth of God's word. How many believe in the Bible? Can I get a yeah in the room? Come on, all right? You believe in the God of the Bible. And he says, he came to demolish every pretension. In other words, any kind of pre-thought or confusing thought of what God said it is, but it really ain't. Let me say it in a little bit more intellectual way. It says this, not only does the devil try to confuse the truth of God's word, he will do that, won't he? The Bible calls him the prince of the air. He will take what the Bible says, you hear it on a Sunday, the Bible says you need to live life this way. He'll grab it in the air, he'll twist it, and let it land on your ears saying, oh, 99% of that is good, but that one thing, it ain't that bad, it could be worse. You know what your boy's doing over there? You could be doing that, but you're just doing this one little thing. And all of a sudden, he'll try to twist what God says is black and white and try to turn it gray. And all of a sudden, we're asking the Bible to live our lifestyle instead of us living the lifestyle of the Bible and the God that we believe in. So he says he came to demolish every pretension that sets itself up against the truth of God's word. In other words, the devil will try to confuse not only the truth of God's word. Hear this. He will try to confuse God's truth about you. He will try to do everything he can to get you to not believe the way that God sees you. That's why I had you lean in and say, you deserve joy. You're not a mistake. You're not unqualified. Jesus says he knew you before you even a thought in your mama's head. And if he didn't need you, he wouldn't have sent you to this earth. Stop letting the devil trick you into thinking anything but what God sees. And you're a champion. You're amazing. You're a winner. You're not a loser. You're above and not beneath. You're ahead and you're not the tail. You can't not help but win because of the cross. Are you with me? Like, I'm not going to buy in and believe something that God says I'm not. And it's like Brandon, do I need freedom? Yeah, you just don't know that you do. You don't think you can have it. It's kind of like the story, have you ever gone to the zoo? And you go to the zoo, and have you ever seen an elephant? And if you see an elephant, they're actually their foot is strapped to a rope. But if you study how elephants are trained, by the way, the largest land mammal on planet Earth, the strongest animal, land animal on planet Earth, they train the elephants from a young age. They put a chain around its foot. But eventually, there comes a day where they replace that chain with a rope. The elephant could easily go break that rope and take off. But even though it could physically be free, mentally, it thinks it is chained and trapped. In other words, it can break free, but it doesn't think that it can break free. Let me tell you right now, that's why I want you to get the God of this Bible, what I'm trying to shout to you today, and proclaim freedom to you. You think you can't find freedom, but no, you can find freedom. You got to stop letting the devil win the things that you've already won in. Come on, are you with me? Stop letting the devil beat you in something that you've already beat him in. He may have power, but he doesn't have authority. The same blood that runs through the veins of Jesus because of the cross, when I say yes to Jesus, is the same blood that runs through you and me. So I'm not going to let the devil trick me into something that is opposite of how God sees me. You are born for a purpose. You're not a mistake. You've not made too many mistakes to where you can't bounce back and rise up to be everything that God has called you to be. It's time to break some new ground. It's time to start believing in yourself again. It's time to stop being defeated by someone who's already been defeated. Come on, are you with me? It's time for you to start believing in you again. I'm sitting here trying to get you all fired up, but practically, how do you identify a stronghold in my life? All right, B, I hear you saying, man, come on. Whew, devil ain't gonna take me down. Like, I'm getting fired up. Like, let's go. Like, I'm ready. Come on. It's like pregame, baby. I'm gonna run through this wall right now. But practically, like, I can go run through a wall, but if I don't know exactly what's tripping me up, then I'll stay bound and chained. What is a stronghold? You can write this down and go pray about it later. Give you a few thoughts and then we'll begin to close. And the team can actually come and join me if they like. When they play on the keys behind me, I preach a whole lot better. Come on. How do you identify a stronghold? It's something that steals your focus. In other words, things that should be a priority in your life but no longer are. Like, all of a sudden, is your job a focus more than your marriage? Is money more important than your family? Something that robs your focus that's more important than church and leading your family to Jesus. It's a stronghold. Something that causes us to feel controlled. Controlled, like maybe you're drinking too much. Maybe you got an addiction. Maybe you're diving into porn. Maybe you're struggling with identity. Something that consumes your emotional energy. We see just mental unhealthiness all throughout everywhere right now during this pandemic. All of a sudden you're experiencing depression. You're experiencing hopelessness. The God that you believe in says you deserve joy, but yet you haven't had a day of joy in 6 months. There's something that stronghold we got to believe God's going to set you free from. You got unforgiveness and bitterness and just shame welling up on the inside of you. A distraction from your purpose. I believe this is a big one. A distraction from your purpose. God put us on this earth to love God and love people. When you get to heaven, you ain't gonna bring your house. You ain't gonna bring your bank account. You ain't gonna bring your car. You ain't gonna bring the clothes that are on your back. You ain't gonna bring nothing with you but people. And the question is, the influence and the circle that God has called you to, are you walking in your purpose to let them know about the goodness of the God that you know? I'm convinced that the devil is okay with you going to heaven as long as you don't bring nobody else with you. That ain't gonna be my life. That ain't gonna be Brandon Barber. That ain't gonna be Elevate People. We started Elevate People. We're gonna love you right where you are, tore up, broke up, from the floor away, no matter how, if you got high last night or on your way into church. We've had so many things there. We've had weed at the altar. We've had alcohol at the altar. Man, we had people walking in that need to be, like, they're getting delivered right on the front row, like screaming, like, woo! They shouting amen at the wrong point every time. But getting radically saved left and right, Why? Because we're going to be known as a church in my life. I'm going to live my life with prayer. Ain't nothing going to hold me back from getting to heaven and bringing as many people as I can with me. And we do it. We just do it by loving people where they are. A stronghold is something that robs us from abundant life. You're in survival mode. If you connect with any of those, there's a good chance you can say yes to the answer, the question that I asked you in the beginning, and that's, do I need freedom? And how do I overcome this? How do I overcome this? I love Luke chapter 11, verse 21 and 22. It says this: here we are facing these things, but we believe in Jesus. The Bible calls the devil, he's a strong guy. I got to give the boy credit where he's at. He's strong. He's got some power. He's taken you and me out many times. Come on, am I right? We've had multiple bad days. He's tried to take out my family. He's tried to take out my marriage. He's tried to take out friendships. He's tried to get me to quit on this job and my calling and my purpose. He's tried to hit me with the dick. He got me. He's strong. The Bible calls him a strong man in verse 21 in the Message translation. It says, when a strong man armed to the teeth stands guard in your front yard at your house, his property is safe and sound. But I love this part. But when a stronger man, come on, comes along, and a stronger man, if you haven't put the words together, come on, how many know a stronger man is who? Come on, it's Jesus, right? But when a stronger man comes along with not just weapons, but superior weapons, then he is beaten at his own game. The arsenal that gave him such confidence is hauled off. And all of a sudden, his possessions plundered. As hard and as big and as strong as you think the devil is, it is no comparison to when you say, Jesus, come into my life, and you invite a stronger man into your situation. When you invite Jesus into your situation, here's what's going to happen. Number one is this: three quick points to close out with the altar. And I'm telling you right now, God can set you free. We're going to pray and we're going to go into another song. Number one is this: you got to identify the lie. He is a liar. Stop believing anything opposite of what God says you are and what you're called to be. Identify the lie, because when you identify the lie, you expose the liar. Just humble yourself and be like, yep, I got this addiction. Yep, I'm dealing with bitterness. Yep, I'm not calling them on purpose. I'm avoiding them. I'm avoiding that. I'm not running in my purpose, in my lane. Here I am having conversations about everything else under the sun and everything on the news and all that stuff, and I'm doing nothing to talk to my neighbor about Jesus. My purpose is lost. Like, identify the thing. Devil's saying, your marriage won't work, your family won't work, your life won't work, you're not going to get that job, you're not going to get that family. Now kill the lie. When you identify it, you expose the liar, and it changes everything. Then it says, you gotta take back your thought life. Go back and read Romans 8, verse 5 and 6. It says, with your mind, you have the ability to take that thought captive, as we read earlier. Take it captive. And the third thing is, replace the lie with God's truth. Replace the lie with God's truth, which is the word of God. Ephesians 6, 10 through 18 says, finally, be strong in the Lord and in his mighty power. Put on the full armor of God so that you may take your stand against the devil's scheme. Take the sword, which is the Bible, the Spirit, which is the word of God, and pray. I'm going to identify the lie in my life. Devil, you said I'm not worthy. You said I'm not good enough. No, no, no. I'm going to take that thought captive. No, my Bible says, my God says, no, I am worthy. I am a son of God. I am a daughter of the Most High. You saying my marriage can't make it? No, no, no. The Bible says, no, I take that thought captive. I'm going to kill the lie, and I'm going to replace it with God's words. And he says, no, restoration is my business. There is no one out of the stretch of the arm of grace of Jesus. Nobody. Identify it, humble yourself, saying, yep, that's it. Grab that thought, whatever's binding you up, wherever you're thinking it, and replace it with God's truth. Start thinking about you the way God sees you. then here's my prayer. 2 Timothy 2:26, for everyone in the room, for everybody watching. They will come. This is my prayer. I pray, man. I pray that they will come to their senses and escape from the trap of the devil who has taken them captive to do his will. I hope my heart, my passion is piercing right through this lens of this camera into your hearts today, because that's my biggest prayer. The hardest thing as a pastor, just a leader, just as a friend, is when you see so much potential in somebody. You're like, come on, just come to your senses. There's a moment I just want to go and slap them. And there's moments I'm like, you have no idea the gift of God that is on the inside of you. You have no idea how your marriage can thrive and your family and the dreams that are inside of you. I just need you to come to your senses. Stop letting this take you down. You got the power and the anointing and the authority. It's time to stop letting it take you out. It's time to break some new ground and to be God has called you to be. Pray you're going to escape today. And I believe God wants to do a miracle. So in the room, bow your head and close your eyes. Everybody watching right now. If you want to, you can bow your eyes in your room or just keep watching the screen, because some information is going to come up on the screen. Or you can text the word prayer. If you need prayer right now, we got a live prayer team waiting to pray for you. You can text the word Jesus. Because here's what I know, everything that I'm saying, I just walked you through how to find freedom. But like I said, it all starts with the relationship with Jesus. And we say every week here at Elevate that Jesus didn't die to be a part of your top three. He died to be number one in your life. We can start there. And I want to lead you in that prayer right now. In fact, if you're saying, I need you, Jesus, text the word Jesus to that number. If you're watching on our online platform or website, you can actually click a button, you raise your hand. You can just type Jesus in the comment section. We'll follow up with you. Wherever it is, just make a declaration right now. Jesus, I need to give you my life. I need to rededicate my life. I'm tired of the hurt and the pain. I'm tired of doing it my way. I want to give you my life, Jesus. And just say the simple prayer. Say, Jesus, thank you for dying on the cross for me. Wash my sins clean. Make me new. Make me whole. Today, Jesus, I give you my life. It's as simple as that. And now, what I want to pray for is those of you, you love Jesus, and those of you just gave your life to Jesus. The Bible says when one comes to heaven, all of heaven throws a party. And we're throwing a party with you right now. But I do feel in my spirit, there's many of you, you love Jesus so much, but there's just something holding you back. You don't feel like you can escape from it. But I want to pray for you. Those in the room, those watching right now, I just believe the touch of heaven and the touch of God has nothing to do with being in the room. I believe right now there's some of you watching. You might be watching high. In fact, that might be true. You got an addiction. You're hooked to porn. You're hooked to drugs. You're becoming an alcoholic. You're hooked to work. I believe in Jesus' name right now, God wants to set you free from your addiction. And I want you to say it to yourself. Even if you got people in the room around you, you can say it to yourself. It may not be the right time to say it in front of your family, your children right now, but eventually go and talk to your spouse, talk to somebody, but just quietly and in your spirit, just say, set me free, Jesus. And then say whatever it is, set me free, Jesus. I believe you're dealing with, some of you are dealing with bitterness, some of you are dealing with pain. You've got jealousy that is rising up. You've been hurt by some people. But don't walk away from a gift of friendship that God has brought in your life. if Jesus went to the cross for me, I can reach out and have an awkward conversation to save a friendship and not let bitterness take me down. I want to pray for those of you with that way. Father, I thank you for anybody that is looking for freedom. I just speak your healing power and touch in Jesus' name. Father, just set them free, Lord. Whatever that's holding them back, God, I pray they wake up tomorrow morning, they have no cravings. They have joy that doesn't make sense. They got hope again. Things are turning around in their lives and in their marriage and their family. They'll get that phone call they've been believing for. They'll get that email that they've been waiting on, Lord God. Things will turn around financially. You'll see joy in their eyes, God. I believe in Jesus' name, they're going to be walking around with freedom and the joy of Jesus like never before. Fill their lives with joy, God. Fill their household with freedom, Lord God. We thank you for it, and we declare it in Jesus' name. Now, I want to encourage you, and the team's going to come worship one more time. You know one great way that you can respond to this, if you're saying, that touched me today? Come on, anybody in the room, I hope it helped you. And if you're watching here today, I pray that it did. This is how you respond. Right now, information is going to be on the screen for to sign up for a group. Don't do life alone. Jesus didn't do it alone. Why would you? Respond right now. You don't have to be in Houston, a part of Elevate Family, to be a part of a group. Get on our website. Text the word group, sign up right now, right now. There's groups for marriages, for families. There's groups for going over books. There's men's groups, women's groups. Commit right now that I'm going to dedicate my time once a week, bi-weekly, that I'm going to walk out this freedom in my life. And you do it through groups. Elevate, this is family. And allow your family to walk with you and to love you through the process. We're going to sing one more song. Come on, team. And I pray that through this song, you don't turn off, you don't turn away. But everything we just prayed for and we believe for, guys, you can stand up with me in the room. Let's just seal it with worship. Worship is our response to God's awesomeness. And I think God has done something pretty awesome here today. And let's seal it with worship in Jesus' name.
Come on, elevate. Let's stand back up. Lift up your hands. The Lord is in this place. He is with us. Hold me now in the hands I created the heavens. Find me now where the grace runs as deep as your scars. You pull me from the clay, you set me on a rock, you call me by your name, and made my heart whole again. Come on, let's sing it. Lift it up and my knees know it's all for your glory, that I might stand with more reasons to sing than to fear. You pull me from the clay, you set me on a rock, you call me by your name, made my heart whole again. Here I stand, high and surrender. Yeah.